So, I'm really kind of excited to be in this room and also, you know, sort of humbled to be up here. I think I'm coming, you know, following someone who's thinking very big, I'm thinking very small. And the things that I've done in the past have been, I've been enormously indebted to lots and lots of people in this room and also at this conference. So, you know, I really find that all of the work of the Grassland Task Force and Katie's great organization and also just the really excellent ornithologists that we have in Illinois and in the Chicago region have been really formative in my thinking as a conservationist and how I can do conservation in my own area. And, you know, so many people have been just enormously generous with me in terms of contributing work and ideas and all of that. And so the last presentation maybe gave something to you from a big picture. I'm up here to take a small picture, but hopefully that will also be an interesting part of this whole process of thinking about grassland birds. The work that I'm talking about has been funded by also the migratory bird program and also the LCC, the Upper Midwest Great Lakes LCC. So this is a picture of Chicago wilderness. So there's you know, mostly in Illinois, but also a little bit in Wisconsin, Indiana, and then just a little tiny bit up into Michigan. However, the main the original boundary of Chicago wilderness was really there, and this is Cook County in Chicago right here. So in Chicago wilderness, we are really lucky to have, you know, like the city founders 100 or more years ago set aside this big belt of forest preserves around the city. And that those preserves have, you know, the most endangered species in the state of Illinois, and they've got a lot of great landscapes, including a lot of grassland. So, you know, the interesting thing about thinking about Chicago wilderness, it gets us thinking about public land, which is something that people don't talk about a lot, but where we are, public lands are really the key. And I think, you know, as you think out across the landscape, public lands often form the core of these grassland bird conservation areas, and there are a lot of issues and challenges in public lands. So, you know, while I completely agree that the appropriate focus is on private lands, I think it's just important for us to think about public lands a little bit as well and what's going on there, because they're definitely a piece of the picture. So we've got this grassland bird task force, and early on in Chicago wilderness, we knew grassland birds were going to be one of our most important conservation targets. We got a bunch of biologists together. We made this conservation design that sat for 10 years. You know, landowners just didn't want to buy into it. They weren't part of making it. And when we brought it to them, you know, they were like, well, why should I do that? So we wanted to come back at it. We put together a different task force. It's got, you know, some biologists, but also a lot of landowners. And so we're thinking through how we can meet these targets in a way that everyone will be able to endorse and buy into. And I mean, we also think that just since a certain amount of time has gone by, a lot of people have really gotten excited about grassland bird conservation and have done a lot of exciting grassland bird conservation. So we'll be able to showcase gains over the last 10 years, which I think will be a big part of being able to sell this. But what we're thinking about right now, you know, is how to go out and sell this thing. And so, you know, I'm eager for any ideas that that you all have discussion, you know, whether it's part of this presentation or afterwards. So our goals are we're going to map grassland bird conservation areas, and I'll talk more about that at the end in the Chicago region. We're going to map the sites that have grassland birds, set acreage and population goals, and then, you know, implement those goals and monitor our progress. So this was, you know, this is what came out of that initial conservation design. We've got birds of dry, mesic, and wet grassland. We've got goals for the breeding pairs, and then we've also made some acreage goals for the different types of grassland. And you see, we also had a goal of having at least 5 grassland habitat complexes of at least 4,000 acres in size. And in 05, we went out and we did a blitz. We challenged local birders to find every single grassland bird in the region. They didn't, but these are our numbers. And so, you know, they found a lot of them. I think we got pretty close. So this just gives you some sense of the birds we know about and our goals, how they compare. In terms of monitoring, what our goal is for this effort is to monitor the acres of habitat we added, and then to monitor abundance and diversity to make sure that those acreage goals are getting us to our population goals. But we want to start with monitoring the acreage. And we have a lot of existing monitoring programs that we want to use as much as possible for monitoring going forward. So our first challenge was to really get a better picture of how many grassland birds were on the landscape so that we could go back and revisit those goals and really come up with realistic goals. And we've been kind of stuck on that for a while. But we did partner up with Chad Wilsey and Justin Schuetz, who are their conservation scientists from National Audubon Society. And Chad is a spatial scientist, and he's doing a lot of the work that you'll see in this section. So, you know, Audubon is very interested in using citizen science results to do good science, and is kind of excited about this effort because, you know, we think it kind of pushes the boundary a little bit of what you can use citizen science for. So, we chose 5 focal species across the moisture gradient, and we're going to compare multiple methods for modeling the habitats. And then we're going to do targeted surveys, ground truthing, to feed into the models. And so we just finished those surveys this summer. So, so we're letting the birds tell us where the habitat is in this modeling, and then predicting the abundance in a continuous landscape. We've got, this is where we have observations from in the region. These are our citizen scientists. So we've got a lot of citizen scientists. They've been active since 98. We've got lots of great data. They're out doing 5-minute point counts during the breeding season. So we're looking at the last 5 years there, and it's abundance data. You know, it's 5-minute point counts, no distance, nothing like that. The modelers chose to look at 2 different data sets. The one is the Landsat, and you know, this just tells you how they processed it. And then we're looking at 2 different spatial scales. Oh yeah, do I remember the 2 spatial scales? So I think it's 10 and 100 meters. Is that sound right? I think so. Yeah. So. That's the one, and then the other, we're looking at land cover data, and this is the way that we consolidate the classes for the land cover data. And you know, you can really see that this central area is where we have a lot of the public lands, and then when you get out, that's where you've got a lot of the ag lands. So, you know, like the thing that we're kind of struggling with is how to characterize those different fields in the ag lands. So, so I'll tell you what we did about that in a minute. But so then this is just some of the different details about the modeling that's going on. And then when we looked at those 2 model performances, the land cover was outperforming the Landsat. And this is sort of an example. This is where we have Hensel Sparrow data from. Here's the land cover, and then here's the Landsat model. So you can see they're very different. And the land cover seems to be working a little better. So we took a look at where were these 2 different models giving us different results, and where are information gaps, and and then we included the places where we had no data in those information gaps, and we came up with these these squares, and so the blue squares are where we wanted more data from. So we did a big citizen science blitz. It was really interesting to see, like, we have lots and lots of birders and citizen scientists in the Chicago region, but would they, you know, drive 50 miles to go look at some grasslands that maybe, you know, ag fields that did not necessarily have grassland birds in them? But we got a lot of people to do it. I mean, I think we got 50 of these squares covered, which is terrific. And so we're getting like a lot more meadowlarks, a small number of more bobolinks, and then just a very few of the henslow sparrows. And I think that's pretty much what's come in so far. But right now, we're in the process of, feeding that data back into our models so that we can take the next steps of then looking at and making our population goals more realistic, and then getting those population goals out to the coalition. The other step we'll be taking soon is reaching out to the landowners who are a part of our working group, and getting some estimates from them in terms of how much grassland habitat they think they're going to be adding, over the next 10 years or so, so that we can just start to think about how to gather data about what people are planning to add in terms of grassland habitat, and start to think about how that looks compared to what we think our goals are. So these are our next steps: building new models, incorporating the new data, generating abundance map. And then this is the imagine from our modelers. It'd be great to have models that could estimate abundance in a year with a single satellite image. Another piece of the project is looking at grassland bird conservation areas. And once we have all this modeling done, we're going to be, we're going to have a much better basis for looking at those. But we just did, for this conference, we did a little preliminary look. So this is Medewin National Tall Grass Prairie and Goose Lake Prairie. So those are two of the public lands in our, in the Chicago Wilderness region. So, we took a look at, let's see if we called that a grassland bird conservation area. It's 45,000 acres, 14,000 of which is grass, and then another 6,500 is ag. So, that's pretty decent as grassland bird conservation areas go. I think these numbers will become much more accurate after we do the modeling. And we looked at another one as well, which also had some promising numbers. So, we'll be doing a lot more of that. And then just thinking about what we have to get out there to land managers, in order to kind of convince them to get on board with this. We're thinking about another effort that we did where we worked with Kane County. We worked with all the public lands in Kane County, which is a county west of Cook. It's fairly rural still. It's kind of like one of the big transition counties. And so we looked at the Illinois Wildlife Action Plan, and we looked at the birds. We chose, some of the birds that occurred in Kane County, and looked at the population goals and saw, that we would have to either increase by 50% or 100% those goals in Kane County. So we thought of, what are all the different management actions that you can do to increase grassland bird numbers. We went through preserve by preserve, and we kind of mapped out, because we had good monitoring data, what was the current functional habitat for those birds, and then where could we gain more habitat by doing some of these management actions. So we coded all those management actions. And then we predicted gains in acreage through these different management actions. And we found that we could actually, just by reversing the degradation on the managed lands, and then also adding in plans that they already had to convert ag land that they owned into grassland, we could gain 51% of grassland. And we did a cost for that, so we had like a low end and a high end cost. So it would cost about $1 million to get 51% more grassland. So we're thinking maybe something like this will be something we should include in what we put out to land managers. Maybe it's a kind of a persuasive way of thinking. Oh, and One other thing I wanted to say is that another thing we're going to do, I didn't put a slide in for it, but we're also going to, in Chicago Wilderness, we have something called a green infrastructure vision, which is a lot of different layers of green infrastructure. And so we're going to be looking at some of those layers and pulling the ones that have to do with flood control, water quality, connectivity, so similar to what Ryan is talking about, and trying to match those up with the grass and birds in order to give a more complete picture that will include some other important values to landowners in the region. So I'm eager for any thoughts that anyone has about the technical aspects of this or the persuasiveness aspects. Thank you very much for listening and thinking about this with me. No, this is because this is all on, publicly owned. So we looked at their public lands. So buying was not included. It was management. We've got a fairly standard set of costs for different management actions. So we actually looked at these actions. So somehow when this thing fell, it brought me to the right. these were the actions we were looking at. We went through with both the monitors and stewards, who had knowledge on the ground, and then also the landowner, and we kind of mapped out where these go.
So I'm very interested in the suburban encroachment and whether there are strategies possible to allow landowners. I know in many communities, landowners have to have a mowed lawn, and it can't be biotically diverse or anything. Is there any ability to change that mindset and allow kind of grassland landscapes around homes in the suburban?
One story that I love is that one time, this was maybe 10, 12 years ago, I called up a guy from the city of Chicago. There was a funding opportunity out there, and I was like, let's do something together. And he said, yeah, Mayor Daley thinks we need more grassland on the lakefront. It's Mayor Daley thinks that. Shouldn't I be the one thinking that? We really have a strong conservation ethic in Chicago Wilderness. I think that's one of the great things that Chicago Wilderness has done is it's pulled in because, we have, the counties are the big landowners there. So it's pulled in all the counties, and then it's also pulled in some of the larger municipal park districts, and it's just really promoting conservation values with all of them. So, it can definitely be done. The Chicago Park District is tearing up lawn and putting in bird habitat at an astonishing rate. They're just sucking up as much money as they can to do that. So, I think it's a really, it's a really important value in our region is to have biodiversity in Chicago. It hasn't seeped down to the general population, I don't think, but I think among municipal planners and certainly public land agencies, it's really important.
So how do you get down to the general constituent of that area?
To the public land?
To the homeowner.
Oh, to the homeowner. Well, a homeowner is not going to make grass or bird habitat, right? I don't think so. I think you need these big grasslands. They need to be 100 acres. You need 100 acres of grass. We of course try to push for bigger and bigger.
Oh, another question here.
Just as a follow-up on that, one thing I saw, maybe you guys had something to do with this. It was kind of on the outskirts of Chicago, I think north of it. Was there had been a big development with good, nice houses, and they're all laid out in the whole development network. But it was also an association that co-owned, communally owned, or however you call it, a whole bunch of land that was in the center of this development and around it. And and it was all ceded to prairie. So it was all people who, you know, appreciated living around prairie, and actually it was a net creation of prairie habitat while also it was a development. I've never seen anything like that before. So is there a lot of that going on here?
Just what you're talking about. Yeah. Okay. That's great.
That's the integrated open canopy coffee concept, you know, that you know, a community can set aside a landscape that's beneficial, you know, as a way of mediating their other activities. It's almost exactly the same thing when it comes to suburban landscape. That's pretty, you know, that's powerful, or could be powerful.
The Indiana Wildlife Federation is doing a spin-off from the Backyard Wildlife Habitat Certification to certify whole developments like what you described. And it really is providing a lot of incentives to do that kind of prairie development around large developments that could be 100 acres and many more in some of our new developments and golf courses and commercial land where like Eli Lilly owns a lot of property that they were spending a lot of money mowing, which is now prairie.
And actually, when I think about it, Northwest Indiana does have a few more of those developments, yeah.
If your park district is very invested in biodiversity values and you've got a great story to tell, seems like representatives from the district and you ought to go to whatever planning network meetings occur and park manager meetings occur and export that value to other cities that may not share it.
Yeah, that's a great suggestion. Yeah, and I mean, luckily we have great networks. So we've got like a wildlife managers task force, and then we've also got a land managers group. So, and they meet regularly.
So this, your analysis assumes that these gains don't come with associated trade-offs or losses.
Right. Right.
So will there be any pushback, like they're getting rid of habitat X to put in habitat Y? Like, are there tough choices to make?
We only look at the easy choices, I think. I think we could have gotten more gains if we had gone for tough choices, but these are, you know, lands that are already designated as grassland, or, you know, that could have pretty easily been, you know, like maybe they were very degraded and they weren't being converted from some other important value, or lands that they had already planned to develop as grasslands, you know, ag lands,